Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 19 February 2019. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these six. The first article we'll be seeing is Cement Makers Happy as Most Favored Nation status to Pakistan is withdrawn by India. Second article is about Occupational Safety and International Vision Zero Conference to promote occupational safety and health. Third article is about Deen Dayal Disabled Rehabilitation Scheme. And the fourth article is about Insect Apocalypse. The fifth article we'll be seeing is about International Court of Justice, and the final one is about RBI's transfer of interim dividend to Government of India. The first article we'll be seeing is Most Favored Nation. Because of the withdrawal of Most Favored Nation tag by India on Pakistan, this has benefited the cement making industry. We'll also see what Most Favored Nation status is and the trade between India and Pakistan here. Here, let's first see what Most Favored Nation status is. So this most favored nation status is defined under WTO GATT agreement clause 1, and according to this agreement, so this status is accorded by one country to another country to ensure non-discriminatory trade. However, according to the same provisions, if one country extends this most favored nation tag to another, it must extend the concession or the privilege to all the other countries who are the members of WTO. Even though this term suggests favoritism towards one particular country, this principle is more towards the concept of equality promoted by WTO in trade. Once a nation is awarded most favored nation status, then there will be concessions with respect to tariffs, more open markets, and free flow of goods and services. So India has awarded most favored nation tag to Pakistan in 1996 itself, that is just 1 year after the constitution of WTO. However, after the recent attacks on CRPF officials in Jammu and Kashmir recently, the Indian government has withdrawn this most favored nation tag from Pakistan. And apart from this, it has also slapped about 200% duty on imports of cement from the country. So with respect to cement industry, imports from Pakistan range from about 40,000 to 50,000 tons annually, and Pakistan has been facing the ease of pricing advantage for quite some time now. However, revoking this tag will definitely increase the make in India in cement industry with respect to India, apart from addressing the concerns of security. Apart from cement, there are few other goods that India exports to Pakistan and few other that Pakistan exports to India. The major goods that are traded from between India and Pakistan include cotton, organic chemicals, plastics, vegetables and other man-made fibers. And the exports to India from Pakistan, apart from cement, include cotton, fruits and other inorganic chemicals. Since the total share of India's exports to Pakistan as well as Pakistan's exports to India is very small, this revoking of the status will not have any widespread impact. So this is considered just a symbolic value, as the balance of trade is already in favor of India. The second article is about the Occupational Safety and Health. Ministry of Labor and Employment has recently conducted an international conference on Vision Zero. We'll see what Vision Zero is and also the importance of occupational safety on the life of the workers. So there has been increasing awareness about the concept of occupational safety and health. So what is occupational safety and health? So this is a concept that takes into consideration not just economic well-being of the workers, but also the psychological, physical and biological risks involved in their work environment. So with this increasing awareness, the Ministry of Labour and Employment has decided to conduct an International Vision on Zero conference today, and it takes into consideration four basic principles in this vision. So the four basic principles are: life is non-negotiable, humans are fallible, tolerance limits are defined by the human physical resistance, and people are entitled to safe transport and safe workplaces. So this area is even touched upon in Sustainable Development Goals. Goal number 3 under SDG talks about health, and goal number 8 talks about decent work and economic growth. So achieving this requires taking into consideration the principles of risk involved in the workspace, ensuring safety of the workers, health in machines, equipments as well as workspaces, along with the skill upgradation of the workforce. So in order to achieve this aims, Ministry of Labour and Employment has ventured into making international collaborations to increase the labor standards in our country. It has already signed an MOU with German Social Accident Insurance Company to increase the occupational safety and health of Indian workers. This international conference will see the participation of 1,200 national and international delegates coming from various fields including occupational safety, health, from manufacturing, mining, as well as construction sector. The next article for the day is about Deen Dayal Disability Rehabilitation Scheme. This scheme is under a preview of Ministry of Social Justice and the importance of this scheme to bring in an inclusive development in our country. So about 2.1% of Indian population, according to Census 2011, they suffer from some form of disability. And in order to provide an inclusive development and bring them into their mainframe, Government of India has brought in amendment to Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act in the year 2016. So this act has diversified the disabilities from 7 to 21, and it has for the first time included disabilities like mental disability and speech and language disability into the ambit. Apart from this, the amendment also provides reservation of 4% of seats for students in higher educational institutions and even imposes strict penalties for crimes committed against persons with disabilities. So apart from this, the government has also brought in many schemes like to rehabilitate the disabled people in our country. So only by rehabilitating the disabled, we can ensure social justice as well as empowerment with people suffering from disabilities. So this scheme, that is Deen Dayal Disability Rehabilitation Scheme, which was launched in the year 2003, it aims to create such an enabling environment to provide equal opportunities for persons suffering from disabilities, and it even encourages voluntary actions to ensure effective implementation of the People with Disability Act of 1995. So under this People with Disabilities Act, it ensures equal opportunities are provided as well as rights of persons suffering from disabilities are met. The government even offers financial assistance to the NGOs, that is the voluntary organizations, to make inclusive change to the lives of the disabled. Funds are provided for providing early intervention support, developing skills of the disabled people, bringing in educational support, as well as providing skill-oriented development to the disabled people, and also to bring in overall awareness about the lives of the disabled people among the general population. And it is also to be noted that about 50% of the total funds transferred to the special children's schools under this scheme goes to eastern and northeastern states. The next article is about insect apocalypse. Recently, a study was published in a journal called as Biological Conservation. It states that almost 40% of all the insect species in the world has declined. So this article will also deal with the negative impacts of climate change on the insect community. So the negative effects of climate change is increasingly becoming evident because of the human intervention such as deforestation, increasing urbanization, conversion of more forest land to farmland and for industrial purposes, pollution from industries as well as from other sources, increasing use of pesticides for agriculture. All these causes pose a serious threat to survival of the insect species. According to this newly released survey, about 60% of the total insects group in Britain has declined and 50% in North America as against 44% in Europe. So this is a very serious trend since insects are very much essential for the purpose of pollination. For example, plants like cocoa, coffee, almonds and cherries, they play a very important role in maintaining the ecosystem, and insects are prerequisite to ensuring their survival as they depend on insects for pollination. And the scientific community also say that this can be considered a sixth mass extinction in the last half billion years, that is in the Anthropocene epoch. And the scientific community also add that about one third of total insect species are threatened with extinction, and about 40% of the bee species are listed as vulnerable for extinction. And the only solution to this mass extinction, according to scientific community, is restoring wilderness areas and a drastic reduction in the usage of pesticides, controlling pollution, as well as increasing afforestation, which will slow down the rate of the insect loss. The fifth article for the day is India requesting International Court of Justice to quash Kulbhushan Jadhav verdict. This article was taken from the paper Hindu. So the International Court of Justice, it began 4-day public hearing of the death sentence awarded to Kulbhushan Jadhav by Pakistani military court. So here for the prelims, we have to know what International Court of Justice is and the functions of International Court of Justice. So this International Court of Justice is the primary judicial organ of United Nations. So it is located in a place called as Hague in Netherlands. And the main purpose and the main functions of this International Court of Justice include to settle down the disputes brought to the court by its member nation. So the judicial court cannot take up any disputes pro motu. It can handle the dispute only brought to it by the member nations. And the second important function of International Court of Justice is to provide legal advice to any organ of United Nations upon request. This court has 15 judges, and the 15 judges, they come from different countries, and they're elected by United Nations General Assembly. And they're elected by United Nations General Assembly and United Nations Security Council. And each judge holds 9-year term. And in order to avoid bias, no two judges can be citizens of same country. And another important point here is the Security Council are not allowed to veto or use any of their special powers during the elections of the International Court of Justice judges. Coming back to the case that is currently proceeding, this case is only fourth one involving the death sentence that is heard by International Court of Justice. So India in its representation, it states Pakistan has violated Vienna Convention of Council Relations. This Vienna Convention of Council Relations was signed in the year 1961 and it came into force in the year 1964. And both India and Pakistan are parties to this convention. So one of the important provisions of this convention according 361B is that any country must observe due process of law. And India cites Pakistan has violated this clause of due process of law according to this Vienna Convention. According to this convention, a country must ensure consular access to the foreign nationals undergoing trial in foreign land, and Pakistan has also violated this Article 36 of Vienna Convention according to India. The final article we'll be seeing is RBI to pay about 28,000 crores as interim dividend to Government of India. This article was also taken from the paper Hindu. So the Reserve Bank of India has approved earlier transfer of a part of its profit to the government. This transfer is called as interim dividend transfer. Usually, RBI transfers its dividend to the Government of India in the month of June, July. And now, based on the limited audit review after applying economic capital framework, RBI's board has approved 28,000 crores as interim dividend to the Government of India. And it is to be noted that this is the second instance of such interim transfer. Back in the year 2018 too, RBI has paid about 100 billion rupees as interim dividend, and now it has approved about 280 billion rupees as interim dividend in the year 2019. So this increase in funds to the government will help the government to bridge its budgetary gap and thus help achieve the 3.4% fiscal deficit target. So apart from this, the government has in all budgeted about 74,000 crore of dividends in the current financial year. And in the next financial year, government will receive about 82,900 crore from RBI as dividend. Thank you.